The broadcast is now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to today's webinar. My name is Tom Reynolds. I'm with Export Solutions. And I'd like to welcome you to today's session about Schedule B and HTS codes. I'm going to go through a few housekeeping items. I know that we have a number of people signed up for this webinar, and many of you are still joining. So the first few slides here in the first few minutes will just be to go over some housekeeping things, and then we'll get into our material for today. Just a quick disclaimer about what we're going to be discussing. We are experts in these regulations, and we have a lot of knowledge and experience, but this disclaimer basically just says that if we provide any information which is contradictory to what is actually written in the regulation, obviously those regulations are the governing authority, and they would control any discrepancy versus what's presented here. Hopefully you can all see the screen and hear my voice, but just some quick tips on how this webinar works. If you've never used GoToWebinar before, that is the program that we use for these sessions. There's two ways that you can participate in audio. One is through a phone call, the other one is through your computer speakers. If you thought that they can't hear us, we provided the telephone number and access code for you. For the duration of this session, we are going to keep everyone muted. We found over 2+ years of doing this that it's just easier to manage the Q&A and interaction with you via chat and via the Q&A function rather than trying to unmute people and actually have dialogue with people. It just doesn't always work, and it's sometimes fraught with technical challenges. So I would just direct all of you to look at the question and answer bar on your GoToWebinar toolbar, and you can use that to communicate with us. We will be taking questions throughout the session. We'll be pausing at various points, and at the end of the material, we will also stop for questions. So we encourage you to submit those questions for us. One of the first questions that I will answer for everyone, which is one that we get very frequently during these sessions, and that is, can we get a copy of the slides from today? The answer to that is yes. We post them on our website. So if you go to exportsolutionsinc.com, which is where you went to register for this session, and you go to the top of the screen, there's a section called Webinars. And underneath that page, you will see a section called Archived Webinars. Typically, within 1 week of the session, we will have the slides as well as a recording of today's session posted on that place on our website. So if you have colleagues who missed the recording or the actual live session, they can go back and play it. Or you can also download a copy of the slides. I would just like to remind everybody that the slides are for your internal use only. And I would like to point out that we have a number of free webinars throughout the year. I think we have 6 currently scheduled for 2014, of which this is like the 3rd one, I believe. So our next one is going to be coming up in August, and it is called The Best Webinar You'll Ever Attend About Export Control. This is actually our longest running webinar. It was one of the first ones that we introduced, and it's a very good basic overview of U.S. export control regulations for people who don't have a lot of understanding about ITAR and EAR. This is a very good starter course for you to attend. So I would definitely recommend this one. It is one of our highest rated ones as well, so it's very popular. And space is limited to 100 for each of these. So if you haven't already registered for it and it is something that you're interested in, go ahead and do that now. Of course, all of our webinars are free. Well, like I said, my name is Tom Reynolds. I'm the Vice President of Operations for Export Solutions. But more importantly, I'd like to introduce you to today's speaker, and her name is Marcy Gentry. Marcy is our Senior Consultant for Trade Compliance. Just to give you a little bit of background on Marcy and where her expertise lies, she's been in the import-export compliance field for more than 17 years, and that experience ranges across a variety of industries as export compliance officers, including for several Fortune 500 companies, such as Dell Computer, Freescale Semiconductor, Nortel Networks, and L3 Communications. Marcy's a subject matter expert in a variety of U.S. and foreign trade regulatory requirements. This includes BIS, DGTC, OFAC, as well as DFATE in Canada. Marcy's been a licensed customs broker since 2004. She's a graduate of the University of Colorado at Denver, majoring in international business. And she was also an adjunct professor teaching import and supply chain courses at the Austin Community College International Business Institute. In the past, Marcy has also participated in the District X4 Council quarterly meetings and discussions for Central Texas. So Marcy joins us today from just outside of Dallas. And welcome, Marcy. How are you?
Great. Thanks, Tom. So I'll get right into today's agenda. Today, we're obviously focusing on Schedule Bs and the Harmonized Tariff Schedule, or you'll hear me refer to it as the HTS code. I'll give you a brief overview on both of these items, both the Schedule B, what it is, when it's used, and then the Harmonized Tariff Schedule and when it's used and the purpose of it. We'll talk about a little bit about what the differences are between the HTS code and the Schedule B code and when you use each one of them. And then I'm going to walk through the Harmonized Tariff Schedule structure, so how you look at the part number, or the part numbers, excuse me, the classification, the structure of the Harmonized Tariff Schedule. But keep in mind, as I walk through the Harmonized Tariff Schedule, it's the same requirements and rules as you'd use for the Schedule B. So the regulations are very similar in nature. There's just a few differences, which we'll talk about as well. And then I'll walk through the general rules of interpretation. And this is really the process of how do I determine the classification for my product. So what HTS code should I use and what are the steps that I should follow in order to properly assess and assign the correct classification. And then I'll give you some useful tools in regards to different places you can go to kind of help you decide on what your classifications are, some of the tools that the U.S. government puts out there, as well as other guidance that may come from the U.S. government. And as Tom talked about earlier, is that we'll have questions throughout, so I'll stop periodically throughout the presentation and we'll take a look at the questions that have been submitted and try to answer those. And then we will, if time permits, we'll answer the questions at the end as well. And for those questions that we don't get back to, we will, or questions that we don't have time for, we'll get back to you in an email format. So the first thing is talking about what the Schedule B is. So what is the Schedule B? I have a lot of clients that ask me, Marcy, what's the difference between the Schedule B and the HTS code, or what is a Schedule B? So while a lot of people focus on things like the export classification number, the ECCN number, or the U.S. munitions list category, there's still another classification that you have to assign to your products when you're exporting them out of the U.S., and that's the Schedule B number. And the Schedule B number is governed by the Department of Treasury, the Census Bureau, and what this number is used for is statistical purposes. So when you're completing your export documentation, certain exports require that automated export system or AES system be filed. When you're doing that, you're required to provide a Schedule B number. The Census uses that Schedule B number to put down their trade statistics. So how many of these widgets were shipped to a certain country? This is really where they get that foreign trade data and that they report on every month. So what is our trade deficit? How much is the U.S. trading with a certain country? That's where those come from, is your Schedule B numbers. In addition to that, which most people don't understand, is that if you are putting your Schedule B number on your commercial invoices, that number may also be used by the importing country to kind of get an idea as to what the classification would be for their import perspective. One of the other things that you want to keep in mind, too, is that the Schedule B number is updated. It's generally updated on the 1st of January every year. Now, that doesn't mean it comes out right on the 1st of January. It's almost like the Harmonized Tariff Schedule number, that there may be some delays. But they generally come out with a new one at the beginning of each year. Sometimes there are some changes to the Schedule B as time goes on. If there's some major changes in the regulations, and they'll usually post that in the Federal Register, but that doesn't generally happen too often. But you always want to make sure that you go back and check your Schedule Bs at the beginning of each year. Go to the Census website, and they publish all of the new HTS codes. And I think this year it finally came out mid-February or towards the end of February with the new HTS or Schedule B codes. Excuse me. This next slide is just to give you the website where you can go to the Census site to download the Schedule Bs. There are some tools here on the Census website where you can either download the entire Schedule B book. They also have another tool, which I'll show you later, where you can put in your product, like the description of the product, and it can help walk you through the classification process. But when you get the slides, you can click on the link and it'll take you directly to the Census website. So going through now, we've learned a little bit about Schedule B. Let's talk about the HTS code. Now, the HTS codes are used for importing purposes, and when they use that HTS code, that's what determines what duty rate that you're going to pay when you're coming into the U.S. In addition to that, it will also use for things like additional duties or additional fees that may be assessed to a certain product, or things like anti-dumping regulations. So there's a lot of anti-dumping requirements around ball bearings, for example. And if you're shipping or you're importing ball bearings from a certain country and a certain manufacturer, you're going to pay a higher duty rate. But what alerts customs is that harmonized tariff schedule number. It's also used for other government agencies, or OGA. If you talk to your customs broker, they refer to it as OGA. Based on your harmonized tariff schedule number, they're going to look at other things if it meets other government agency requirements, such as FDA requirements. So if you're importing lasers or pharmaceuticals, are your items approved to come into consumption into the U.S.? Have they gone through the proper testing and been approved by these different agencies when they come in? So that's a lot of what the HTS is used for. One of the things you want to make sure that you look at is that you're looking at the U.S. Harmonized Tariff Schedule. The HTS, just meaning what it is the Harmonized Tariff Schedule. This is used by other countries as well. So the purpose of the Harmonized Tariff Schedule is that most countries are going to classify their products the same way that the U.S. does, and that's up to a certain point when we talk about here how it's structured. But that's where the word harmonized comes from, is that they're trying to get all the countries around the world that's part of the World Trade Organization to use the same type of classification structure and rules for classifying products. You can find the Harmonized Tariff Schedule online. You can go to the Customs website. Here's another link that we have that you can go to that will give you a complete list of the Harmonized Tariff Schedule that you can download. I will tell you there's lots of vendors that are out there that will sell you the Harmonized Tariff Schedule in a hard copy format. They're generally around $200-$300 per year, and they'll send you the updates when there's changes to the regulations. And just like the Schedule B code, the Harmonized Tariff Schedule is changed every year in January, but there's usually updates in July as well. So you really want to make sure that you're checking the regulations and making sure that your Harmonized Tariff Schedules that you use today aren't being changed to another number. So you want to make sure you keep an update on that. And other times there may be some changes to the regulations. So if there's been some type of customs case where there has been evidence of a company that's dumping goods into the U.S. or illegally dumping goods into the U.S. at a lower cost to try and put U.S. manufacturers out, they may add a new Schedule B or HTS number to the books so that they can track those items coming in. So you just want to make sure that you have some way of getting updates to these regulations. You can sign up on Customs. Another good resource of getting updates to the Harmonized Tariff Schedule is having a good dialogue with your customs brokers. A lot of times they will notify you if there are some changes as well. So really the difference between the HTS and Schedule B, once again, the HTS code is used from the importing perspective. The Schedule B is used from the exporting perspective. They are both 10 digits. A lot of times the Schedule B code and the HTS code are the same code for many products. As you'll see on this bullet point here, there's about 200 codes that are different, to where when you're exporting the product out, you will have to have a separate number for the Schedule B number, and it's usually the last 2 to 4 digits of the code that change. And I'll explain that here in a little bit as we go through what that numbering structure looks like. There are also some codes that are in the HTS that you cannot use from the exporting perspective, and that's generally Chapters 98 and 99. Chapters 98 and 99 are reserved for the U.S. or for individual countries to put some exceptions into their import regulations. And what I can give you an example of is Chapter 98. A lot of codes that are in there are things like U.S. goods return. So U.S. goods that are coming back to the U.S., like unwanted shipments or goods that are coming back for repair. So there's those codes that are in there to kind of help with duty-free treatment of some of these goods so people don't have to keep paying duty on things that are made in the U.S. Those types of codes cannot be used on the AES record. And I won't spend a lot of time on the Chapter 98, 99, just for the fact that you could use a whole webinar just to explain the requirements behind using those codes and what you need to do to meet those. There is a link here on the website that once you get the slides you can go to. There's a list here of the different AES codes or the codes that the HTS codes that you cannot use for filing your AES record. So it's not just 98, but there are some other codes that you're not allowed to use when you're filing an AES record. And Tom, I'll stop there to see if there's any questions so far.
At this point, we don't have any questions. So just a reminder for everyone that if we do cover anything or if you want to clarify anything that we discuss or have questions, just go ahead and use the Q&A function on the GoToWebinar toolbar, and we'll be happy to answer that for you.
Okay, thank you. So the next piece here is I want to talk about the structure of the harmonized tariff schedule as it is to the U.S. And also from the World Compliance Organization. If you look at the regulations under the World Compliance Organization, they're set up the same way. Also, if you look at the Schedule B, it is set up the same way. But the key thing that you want to take a look at is that there's 21 sections, and within those sections there are chapters. And that's helpful because if you look at the section and you're trying to classify your product, look at the sections first. So the example that I have up here on the screen, section one being live animals and animal products. So if you are trying to import a cow, then this is the section you go into, section one. Then you can go and look in the chapter. So is it a live animal? Is it just the meat of the animal? So forth and so on, or the different type of animal. So then you would go to the proper chapter. And that's the way that the whole regulations are set up. And I want to just show you the regulations too. Tom, I'm getting just a little bit of feedback too.
Okay, sorry.
No problem. So just to give you an idea, we have the general notes section, you have your sections, you have your chapters within each one of those. One of the things I want to also point out is that you want to take a look at the section notes, and then there's chapter notes, and we'll go through those in a little bit too. But as you can see, you've got all these different sections and you want to keep going through. So kind of boil it down as you go through the regulations as to which section and then the chapter within those items. So let's talk about the structure of the HTS code. When you look at an HTS code, the first two digits of the code is the chapter. So just show you the section and then you go to the chapter. So the first two is the chapter, and then the first four is really the chapter, and then there's two more digits, which is that we refer to as the heading, and then the first six digits are the subheading. So when you open up the tariff schedule and you find your chapter, this is what it's going to look like. As you see over here to the left, the 85, so you are in chapter 85, then the subheading, it kind of goes down to your higher level description. So here we have vacuum cleaners. Then it gets into a more specific detail when you start getting into the four and the six digits. So here it's vacuum cleaners with self-contained electric motor, and then it keeps diving down further and further. So you really have to take a look at how the paragraphs are structured when you're deciding what your classification is. So here you're going to see a vacuum cleaner with the self-contained electric motor of a power not exceeding 1500 watts and having a dust bag or other receptacle capacity not exceeding 20 liters. So there's this right here, if you can meet this whole thing, your classification is going to be 8508-110000. Some of the other things you want to take a look at, I talked about the first six digits. The first six digits of this HTS code are also used by other countries. They should be the same for other countries that are part of the World Trade Organization. So if you're shipping something to Mexico or you're shipping something to the UK, to start it off, the first six digits should be the same for that same type of vacuum cleaner going to Mexico and to the UK. Now, what may be different are the last four digits. Not all countries have these 10-digit codes. Some countries have 12 digits. Some have only the six digits. Some have eight digits. So each country is a little bit different after the six, and it's just how they want to keep track of goods that are coming in and out of their country. So just keep in mind those first six digits should be the same. One of the other things I want to point out here is when you open up the HTS code, you find your classification. How you find out what your rate of duty is over here on the right side where these columns are. So for that vacuum cleaner that's under 8508-1100, you're going to pay their duty free. So there's no duty that's assessed. That doesn't mean you're not going to have customs fees. You'll still have to pay your merchandise processing fee and the other fees that you may have depending on how you're bringing the item in. But this column right here will tell you what your duty is. The second column, which is blank for vacuum cleaners, is really the column for items that may be eligible for a free trade agreement, like the North American Free Trade Agreement, NAFTA, or CAFTA, or GSP, or the Singapore Free Trade Agreement. If your product's eligible for one of those free trade agreements, they're going to have acronyms over here, like for NAFTA, they'll have the NAFTA MX or CA, their country codes, basically, telling you which agreement that they are available for, and if there's duty assessed or if they're duty free. Because some of the free trade agreements, they're new ones, and the duty is decreasing as years go on. A lot of them, they're free. But if the item's eligible for a free trade agreement, it'll be in this section here. Under this column two, these are for the countries that the U.S. does not do a lot of trade with, such as Cuba or North Korea. You may say, well, if we're not allowed to do trade, why do they even have that on here? In some cases, if you get the import license to bring those items in, then this is the duty that would be assessed to those items coming in from those countries. And in some cases, it may be that there are some items that no other country produces, and they're the only country in the world that produces it, and the U.S. allows them to come in. Or it may be a diplomatic mission that may be coming over or something. So these would be the duties that would be assessed. So moving on to what it is that you need to use when you're classifying something. When you assign a classification, you always want to make that legal argument as to why you feel your item fits that particular classification. So in other words, when you look at your product, you're going to get your specifications on the product. What type of metal is it made out of? What is it used for? Is it a part or a component? Is it something that's shipped by itself? So you're going to look at all these different things on the item that you're importing to make sure that you can assess the proper classification, and then compare that to the notes that are in the regulations. So when I showed you earlier on the harmonized tariff schedule, in the sections in the chapter, I said there's notes. There's always notes for each section, there's always notes for each chapter, and in some cases there are subheading notes for each subheading, and you have to look within the regulations themselves. So let me show you again what I'm talking about here. When you look at here, there are these section notes. You always want to read these section notes because they will give you sometimes definitions of items. They may explain what they mean by a certain type of processing, or tell you that an item doesn't meet this definition if it hasn't gone through this type of manufacturing process. So in section one, they just give an example. What may or may not be included into that section. Section notes apply to every chapter under that section. So that's one of the things you want to keep in mind. If you are dealing with a chapter, there may be chapter notes in each section. Oops, and that one's probably not a good example. Go back here. Let's go to 84. So in 84, it starts with the section notes, and then you're going to start getting into your header notes, or your chapter notes. And here are your chapter notes. For chapter 84, then it's going to tell you here, within this chapter, these things are not covered. So you always want to make sure that you read those notes, because what you may be classifying may be kicked out of that particular chapter, and then give you an idea as to where you're going to go. It will also give you definitions of other things that are in there. So you want to make sure that you read all of those different notes, because it has a key decision factor as to whether or not your item fits into that heading or subheading later on in the chapter. The next legal requirement that you want to look at is using the general rules of interpretation, or what they refer to as the GRI. And what we'll go through is the steps of the general rules of interpretation and what that means. Really, the general rules of interpretation are steps 1 through 6, what you go through in order to get to those classifications. So it'll tell you to read the section notes, and we'll go through each one of those, so I won't spend too much time on that. But the key thing here is that when you're classifying, you want to be able to say, I classified my item under this HTS code as per a general rule of interpretation. One, it meets this, and it meets this definition under this section note, therefore it's 85, blah, blah, blah. And the reason why you want to do that is because if Customs ever questions it, you've imported an item in, and then all of a sudden you get a CF-28 or CF-29 from the Customs inspector, they come in and say, why did you classify this item this way, or give us more information. You want to be able to have that legal response back to them and saying, well, here is our spec and this is why we classified it, because we went through the general rules of interpretation, we used this general rule, and we based it off the definitions in this section, and therefore we classified it this way. So you just want to be able to walk it through as to why you classified something the way that you did. So let's go through what the general rules of interpretation and what the foundation is. So we just talked about this. The first thing you really want to do is you want to go through the tariff schedule, look at the sections, then look at the chapters, and then go through the headings. So those first four digits of the heading, you want to make sure you keep going through those. So if you don't meet this area, then you go to the next heading, then you go to the next heading. And if you come across the heading that you believe your item falls into, then you start going under and looking at each subheading. So just kind of going down the list in that paragraph format. And we'll go through some examples here a little bit later. So going on to what the first general rule of interpretation is, keeping in mind that you're going through those sections, you read the notes, you're doing those items, you want to take a look at each one of those things. They do have an alphabetical index that's part of the harmonized tariff schedule, but even if your item is listed in that alphabetical index, you can't use that as your legal basis for why you determine something to be the way that it is. It's really there to be used as a tool, the same thing with the table of contents and the chapter and subchapter headings. You really have to go back and take a look at your section notes and your chapter notes to make sure that item wasn't kicked out. So there'll be things like screws. Screws are in lots of different places within the harmonized tariff schedule number. It really now boils down to, what is that screw made out of? Is it plastic? Is it metal? What type of metal? Is it brass? Is it stainless steel? So there's certain things there that you have to be able to go through. So don't just look through and find screws somewhere, metal screws, and think that it falls under Chapter 73. You have to take a look at it as if it's called out somewhere else. So general rule notes, the general rules of interpretation, once again, make sure you read all the notes, look at all the definitions, look at the words that are in quotes. Anytime there's something in quotes, in a there's a definition somewhere within the regulation. So make sure if you see anything where there's a quote or the word that's in quotes, that you go and look at the section notes or the chapter notes to find out what the definition is. Some of the notes may only apply to the U.S., so I talked about this harmonized tariff schedule system is based on the World Customs Organization and what the countries that have agreed to that are part of the World Trade Organization, they've agreed to a higher set of definitions and terminology that can be used. The U.S. may have even refined that further. So some of those notes that you have in the U.S. Harmonized Tariff Schedule may not apply in other countries. Just keep that in mind if you're dealing with other countries. There also may be things like formulas or descriptions of items. Once again, there may be things like manufacturing processes. In order for something to meet a definition of an item, it may have to go through certain types of manufacturing processes to meet that. Here's an example of one of the section notes, and I showed you that already. But this is where another example is that they are kicking things out of this. So we've got the section 15 where it says the section doesn't cover certain items. So for example, umbrella frames or other articles of heading 6603. So if you have an umbrella frame that's made out of stainless steel, then or aluminum, it doesn't fit under the section of base metals, even though it's basically metal. But and we're going to go through that further. They're telling you, go check a different section. It doesn't fall under this. Section 2, the chapter notes, so mixtures of products of headings of 0904 to 090910 are to be classified as follows. So this is kind of where we get into some of the key things as to where items would be classified. So this is looking at things that are mixtures of liquids. So mixtures of two or more of the products of the same heading are to be classified in that heading. So you just want to keep taking a look at it as you go further and further down. Further on with the general rules of interpretation, the example 3, this one is a key one, especially if you're dealing with parts and components, especially those that are made out of metal. This is a key definition that you want to take a look at. What is a base metal? You'll see base metals all the way through the regulations, and so you really want to take a look at these section notes to say this is what a base metal is. That's not always the same terminology that may be out there in industry as to what customs is using. So make sure you take a look at all of those different things. Another example, Chapter 72, Iron and Steel. Here are some different percentages and formulas basically as to what qualifies as a different type of metal. So you'll see when you go through the headings and the subheadings, they refer to things as pig iron. This is going to tell you what really qualifies for the, as that particular item that they're talking about. Any questions so far?
Yeah, Marcy, we have one question, and that is, can you explain AES record in a little bit more detail?
Sure. So the AES record is the automated export system record. It's required for exports. If you are ever exporting an item out of the U.S. that requires an export license from either the Department of Commerce or the Department of State, you have to file an AES record. If you're sending out an item that does not require a license, then it goes based on the value, and it goes based on the value per Schedule B number. So if you are shipping out a value of $2,500 or more per Schedule B number, you're required to file an AES record with the department, with the Census Bureau. And those AES records have to be filed within a certain time frame. Basically, if you're shipping your item out via aircraft or airplane like FedEx or UPS, then it has to be filed 2 hours before the plane departs. There's other requirements if you're going by rail, truck, or ship. And what happens, and I'll give you the airline example, is that they won't load the cargo onto the aircraft unless they see the AES record, internal transaction number, what they refer to as the ITN. So that AES record, it's a requirement from an export perspective if you're shipping items out. And if you need a little more detail on that, I can provide more detail. I don't want to spend too much time here going over that. But just keep in mind it is a requirement from an export perspective for certain exports.
Okay. Thank you.
So I'll move on here to the general rule of interpretation too. There's really two parts to the general rules of interpretation. The first one, and I'll read it out, even though I know you probably see it right here, but it's articles that are incomplete or unfinished, unassembled, or disassembled. These are items that are complete. So this is an item. It's been manufactured. You're getting ready to ship it off to your customer. How you classify that item is based on what they say the essential character is of an item. And I'll give you some examples in a few minutes here. The next part of the general rule of interpretation, number two, deals with mixtures and combinations. So how do you classify something that may be a mixture, such as chemicals or items that may have different mixtures of like two different spices together? So let's say you've got a lemon pepper spice. How do I classify that as a lemon spice or a pepper spice? So that's what GR GRI 2 means, and we'll go through that in detail here too. So let's first describe what essential character is. So essential character varies for different kinds of goods, so it must be determined on a case-by-case basis, and this is kind of where your legal argument is. When people submit rulings to the customs, or when there's a question about why somebody classified something a certain way, one of the key things you want to argue is, well, the essential character of my item is this because blah, blah, blah. And the essential character may be determined by lots of different things. So here are some of those things: by the weight, by the value, the quality, the bulk, the nature of the material or component. So there's lots of different things that are there that you want to base what your essential character argument is on. And there's, and we'll talk about some more examples as we go through the presentation in that too. So here's an example of general rule 2. This deals with unfinished goods. So if you have an item, and this example here is an example of an earring. So in this case, you've got an earring, it's the dangler, it doesn't have the post on it, and you're importing that item into the U.S. Once it's here into the U.S., then the post and the back of the earring will be soldered on to the dangle of the earring. And what is it? What is the classification of that dangler? So the way that this would be classified is that the item is going to be classified as an earring, because the essential character of this dangler is an earring. It won't be used for anything else. They're just going to put a post on it, and then they're going to put the back of the earring on it. So there's a customs ruling here. There's some more details. The customs ruling is down here at the bottom, this New York N2, that's what the NY stands for, it's for New York, N211235, and you can find that on the customs website, the cross website, and I'll show you where that is too in a little bit as well. But this is one of the things that when you're classifying an item, if you're importing items that are not completely finished or completely assembled, you want to take a look at the essential character once again and see if you can make the argument as to the item that's coming in, can it be used on other things, or is it really almost to its final point? Other good examples are things like shirts. So you bring in a shirt that comes in, and then later you put a logo on it, or you do some screen print on it. It's really a shirt, even though it doesn't have the screen print or the logo on it. So it's still a shirt, even though it's not in its completed form. Another example of general rule of interpretation to unassembled goods. So in this example, this would be like a kit that you would purchase maybe from IKEA or from the Container Store or something of that nature, where you're buying this closet kit that you can put up in your closet to make an organized closet. When it's being imported in, it comes in the form of shelves and metal rods to hook the shelves onto, and the screws and the bolts and fasteners. So all of those things, when they're packaged together and they're coming in, the essential character of that kit is that closet organizer. And so this is also another ruling that came out of customs, that this, all of these items, when they come in together, and that's the key thing, when they come in together, then this becomes classified as furniture or other types of furniture. Okay. And once again, you can find that ruling on the CROSS website, and that's down here in the bottom as well. But the key thing here is that they have to be packaged and shipped in the same container, meaning you can't just ship the screws, a whole box of screws in one box and a whole box of the shelves in another box, and then you bring them in and then you put those parts together into another package and then throw it out on the shelf, because what that's going to look like to customs is that you've got a box of screws, you've got a box of metal rods, you've got a box of shelves. And that, in that case, you're going to have to classify each one of those things individually. So what it is that these items are packaged together and it's ready to go. And so that's where you start getting into this essential character. What is the essential character of the item that's coming in? Here's under the general rules of interpretation to mixtures and combinations. So here's a couple of questions here. You've got an umbrella hat. So is it really an umbrella or is it a hat? The next example we have here is a jar that has a homemade candle type of scent in it. So what are these items and how are they classified? Well, the umbrella hat is the main essential character of it is to be an umbrella and not a hat. Some people may have that argument, but I'll tell you this is actually another case, and I think this is an example that Customs gives out, but they classify this as an umbrella. So on the candle, or is it this jar on the second product, the essential character is a candle. And this is the ruling here on this note. Because they're selling that product as a candle, they're not selling it as a jar. So basically the jar really is just the container for the candle. So what they classify this as is the candle, and there's the customs ruling for that particular product as well, if you want to take a look at that later on. If you still can't figure out what the classification of your product is under the general rules of interpretation 1 or 2, then you have to go to the general rule of interpretation 3. And before I go through that, I'll stop and see, is there any questions, Tom, on the GRI 2? Nope. Might be on mute. Well, if there is, we'll go back to it. The general rule of interpretation 3, like I said, if you can't get through, if you can't figure out your classification based on 1 or 2 or the legal requirements in 1 or 2, then you go to general rule of interpretation 3. And this has 3 sections to it. 3A, you go with the most specific detailed heading. So whichever one best describes the item. So this is where the essential character is kind of hard to figure out. You've got a combination and it's still hard to figure out really what the essential character is. Then you want to go to the heading that's most specific to that item. General rule of interpretation 3B deals with mixed goods, composite goods, and goods put up in sets for retail sale and the use of essential character. So we'll talk about that when those are really where there may be 3 or 4 different essential characters. So what do you do? And that also then brings us down to 3C, which is the last heading in the numeric order. And don't worry too much, we'll go through what each one of these are here in more detail. So under the example for general rule of interpretation 3A, we have an electric spin toothbrush, which could potentially be classified in heading 8509, and 8509 is electromechanical domestic appliance. That's what that heading stands for. With self-contained motor and heading, the other heading that could possibly fall under is 9603 as a brush. So going through that 3A is you want to go for the heading that is more specific to what it is that you're classifying. So under the toothbrush, brush closely matches more than what an electromechanical domestic appliance is. So you really want to take a look at 9603. So let me show you too. Got the example. Here's 8509. Under 8509, the heading says electromechanical domestic appliance with self-contained electric motor. That really doesn't explain that it's a toothbrush and what the purpose of the item is in that much detail. Whereas if you look at 9603, there's a little bit more detail there. It's a brush. So it's a toothbrush. It's a brush. Brush is closely defines it better, even though it doesn't say toothbrush. It's a better description of what the item is. And as you go through, you can actually see that toothbrushes are called out further on in the statistical notes or legal notes of that section. This actually was another ruling by Customs. What they did say is that the spin toothbrush itself would go under 8509, believe it or not, but the replacement brush head would go under 9603. So the argument that we just had is that brush closely fits it. Customs did not agree. They broke the brush up, toothbrush up, and said, well, just the replacement heads would be the brush, because because it is a mechanical device, it's going to go under 8509. So those are some of those questionable areas too when you're dealing with customs as to where this falls into. And I would always advise, if it gets to this, you're not quite sure where it is, go in for a ruling. A ruling into customs can take a month, it can take 6 months, it just depends. You want to go into the headquarters and not necessarily your port for that customs ruling. But once again, if you do a ruling, you're going to have to provide lots of specifications on the product and your legal argument as to why you feel the item is there. Another example of general rules of interpretation, 3A, so the most specific heading. So an example that we have here is an unframed safety glass made of toughened or laminated glass that is shaped and identifiable for use in airplanes. So there's two possible headings. We have safety glass heading 7007 and parts of aircraft or spacecraft under heading 8803. So do we look at this as safety glass or do we look at this as a part of an aircraft? Because it is safety glass for an airplane. Well, Customs came back and stated that this is safety glass 7007. So when this item goes out, it would actually go under 7007 and not part of an aircraft. Now, if that safety glass is already on the aircraft, then it goes out as the aircraft. So not to be confused, but you want to make sure that just because something is a part of something else, you need to go back and look in your headings to see if there's something else that calls it out in more detail. General rules of interpretation 3 is in regards to things like items that are put up in sets, in a retail set. So this would be things like you'd see at Home Depot on Father's Day where they would have a hammer and a wrench put together. So what is the essential character? Is it that of a hammer or that of a wrench? Because you have both items. But they're put up for a set as a gift set or something of that nature. So what it really is the item classified as. So it really has to consist of two different items. It really has to be two different items in the heading that have two different essential characters. They do have to be packaged and ready for retail sale. So that they're available to them without repacking. They also have to be items that have the same type of activity. So I gave you the example of the toolkit, the hammer and the wrench they're used to build. So those are the types of things that they look at. There's a note here, in some situations no ingredient, material, component, or article will be found to impart the essential character to a particular good. In such instances, resort would need to be made to general 3C in order to classify the good. So let's give some examples here. So what does all that mean? Here's an example that we have, a retail set that's up for sale, let's say at Michael's or one of the other craft stores. There's three prepared canvases, as well as three wooden frames, three paint brushes, six small tubes of paint, and one plastic palette for the paint. So when you put all of those together and they're sold as a set, what is the classification? Because you've got lots of essential characters here. You've got the canvas, you've got the paint, you've got the brush, and then you've also got a palette for the paint. So how should they be classified? The way that Customs looked at this is they put it into 5901, the essential character imparted by the prepared artist canvases. So what they looked at this is that you're going to use the paint on the canvas, so the essential character here is going to be that of the canvas. General rules of interpretation number 3, the last heading, the description on this one, you've got a frame with a clock in it. So is the classification a clock or is it a picture frame? One of the things that it came back to is under general rules of interpretation, you look at what falls last in the heading. So both are an essential character. The clock is an essential character, and it doesn't have anything above what the picture frame is. They both serve pretty much the same purpose, or have equal purposes on this particular product. So what you would do is you use the last heading or last harmonized tariff schedule in the tariff schedule for your classification. And I say I have a clock, but it's not clock. It should be the picture frame is what you use. Okay. The general rules of interpretation, GRI 4. And I'll stop there and say, Tom, is there any other questions at this point?
No questions right now. We have some people that are raising their hand, and I just want to remind everyone that we're not going to be unmuting people for that. So if you've raised your hand and you do have a question, please type it into the Q&A toolbar, and we'll address it that way.
Okay. Thanks, Tom. So we'll continue on to General Rules of Interpretation 4. A general rule of interpretation for goods which cannot be classified using any of the other general rules, 1 through 3, should be classified according to which they are most akin or most related to. This is a tough one to prove to customs, but if you have no other way of doing it, this is one of those last resort type of things to classify your item. Really, this depends on things such as the factors, description, character, purpose, or intended use, destination, production process, and nature of the goods. You can use your competitors' goods and see if they have classifications out there. A lot of people will do that, do their classifications based on other rulings or things that their competitors have done, or a ruling that you may have gotten on a similar product. That's fine. But you really want to make sure that you've gone through all these other rules of interpretation, and you really want to do those comparisons of saying how this really is like something else. But really what it's also looking at is the product itself. So if the product, there's nothing really else called out on the regulations for the product, you really want to take a look at the product and see what is the product most likely used for. What could the essential character be if there's not really a defined essential character? So the example that I have here is an oval tin with a plastic handle. Got this. These are actually pretty popular in Japan. What is this thing? Is it a bag? Is it a tote? Is it a lunchbox? There's lots of different things that you could probably say that this item is. What Customs came back with on this particular product is that they had this item classified as 4202, which provides for trunk, suitcases, vanity cases, attaché cases, briefcases, and similar containers. Really what they were looking at is that this is like a lunchbox. Lunchboxes kind of fall into that, or you can store your items in there. So they looked at it as a case. Moving on to general rule of interpretation number 5. This section also has two different areas. These two sections deal with the various types of containers that may be used or sold with a good. And let's take a look at what we're looking at. What they're stating is that if you bring an item in with its container, then the item is going to be classified as the item. The container will be classified the same way as the item is. You just have to add that value into it. And generally what those containers are, they have to be a long-term container, so it's not a one-time use thing that you throw it away, you're just shipping the item in and then it's gone. It'll be a long-term type of item. So those are things like pelican cases. They may be things like instrument cases, those types of things. Container normally sold with such an item. So when you buy the item, that container comes with it. Okay. It does not apply to containers that get the imported article its essential character. Hey, Tom, I hear some feedback again. Sorry. So some of the examples that we have here are things like camera cases, the musical cases, gun cases. Generally, a lot of those items can be sold with the cases, or those items would be sold with their cases. So under General Rules of Interpretation 5A, if you are importing a guitar with its guitar case, then you classify the guitar case as the guitar. So you just add that value of the guitar case onto your line item with the guitar, and then you pay the same amount of duty as you would with the guitar. If you are shipping those guitar cases empty, then you have to classify them as a guitar case, and you would use the HTS code for that guitar case and with the pay the duties and taxes that are allotted to the guitar. So you do have to ship the item with its case. You can't just ship the case in by itself. I will also give you another example. There was a computer manufacturer that used to sell their products with a laptop carrying case. And the laptop case had sections to put files in, where you could put CDs and pens and business cards. And they would use that particular rule, General Rule 5A, to say these laptop bags that we're bringing in with the computers aren't dutiable. They're the same duty rate as laptops, which at that time was duty-free, and these laptops are still duty-free. But they were trying to get those laptops cases in duty-free because they would ship the laptops with the case and call it a laptop case. However, customs didn't look at it that way because the laptop case could also function as a briefcase. It wasn't a case that was made specifically for that laptop. It was a general use laptop case, and it had other uses such as holding the cards, holding the pen. So you have to be very careful too when you're looking at those a general rule interpretation 5 to make sure that that item is made specifically for that particular product and it doesn't have some other function. Another example here is this crystal candy dish sold with candy. So is the candy dish, is it a holder for the candy? Well, the answer to that is no. Really, the essential character here is the candy dish. It's the crystal dish. The candy is just something that's put on top of it, right? So the way that customs would look at this particular item is that it's not a package for the candy, because a normal type of packaging for candy would be like a plastic bag that the candy would go in, not a crystal dish. So you, once again, you want to be careful with that type of product that you're using or case that you're using when you're using exemption or when you're using General Rule of Interpretation 5. General Rule of Interpretation 5B, so the second part of this, packing containers and materials not meant for reuse are classified with the articles in which they are presented. So, for example, these are things like the bubble wrap, styrofoam peanuts, and cardboard boxes, or even foam that some of these products have. They're intended to be thrown away. You don't have to assign a classification for the peanuts inside the box that you use for packing material. This does not apply to packaging materials or packing containers clearly suitable for repetitive use. So some examples of that would be things like metal drums. So a lot of times people will go through and bring in metal drums for reuse. You actually have to classify those metal drums if you're bringing them in, and they're going to be reused. General Rules of Interpretation number 6, it prescribes that for legal purposes, General Rules 1 through number 5 govern classification at the subheading levels within the same heading. So basically it's saying go through and look at the General Rules of Interpretation. Based on the General Rules of Interpretation, pick out the proper heading and subheading. So there we go. So what does that mean? Okay, so the example that I have here is organic cherries. So as you're going through, you've gone through your general rules of interpretation. The essential character here is a cherry tomato. You're reading the headings, you're reading the sections, and you see that you've got your heading and subheading heading, tomatoes fresh or chilled. You have to keep going down lower by lower to make sure that you get the proper classification for your product. And I use this as an example because under the cherry tomatoes, it depends on the time of year that these items are being imported. And they may have a different classification dependent upon the time of year that they're imported. So while most people will think I only have one classification per product, that's not necessarily true. If you're dealing with things like hardware and those types of things, you're generally fine. It's generally agriculture that you need to be worried about. So let me just kind of give you this example. As you walk through the regulations, you need to reach each subheading. So here we've got tomatoes fresh or chilled. The next thing you need to look at, if entered during the period from March 1st to July 14th inclusive, or the period from September 1st to November 14th, inclusive in any year. So it needs to be entered in during that time frame, and you would get this HTS code. But now you got to go down even further. Is it a greenhouse tomato? Well, this is not a greenhouse tomato. It is an organic cherry tomato, so we need to keep going further. It doesn't meet greenhouse, so we're going to go to the next item underneath it, see how these are lined up. You want to make sure you're still lined up. We're going to go to other. Under other, do we meet any of these other items? Cherry tomato. So we have an organic cherry tomato. It fits into that definition of cherry tomato under other. So your classification, if you're importing those items on March 2nd, is going to be 07-0200.2035. Use this last statistical note. If you're going to import it at any of, during these times in the during these other periods of time, then you would use the same, you would use the next classification. So if you're going to import it in on July 16th, then it's going to be 07-0200.4035. One of the other things that I point out is this is one of those things where the Schedule B code and the HTS code do not match. So you want to make sure that you are checking your Schedule Bs to see if they are the same as your HTS codes. Because I know a lot of companies will just use HTS codes and never check their Schedule B codes. Then when they get ready to file their AES record, an error comes up and says that's not a valid Schedule B code, because it's not. The reason why there's differences here is that from a U.S. perspective, they don't care about the tomatoes that are being exported out of the U.S., and they do to get their trade statistics, but what they do care about is protecting farmers from other countries bringing in lower priced goods that may hurt our farmers in the U.S. So that's why they have these different HTS codes to have higher duties on these products when they come in at certain times of the year so that they don't harm our own farmers. So that's why there's a difference here. And that's a lot of what some of those statistics and changes are between the HTS and Schedule B codes. It depends on what the U.S. government's trying to track of what's going out of the U.S. and what's coming in. So that's why there's those differences between those two. Under the general U.S. rules of interpretation, so this is in addition to the general rules of interpretation, we have the U.S. rules of interpretation. And I'm going to stop before I go into that and see if there's any questions, Tom.
Yes, we do have a few questions. The first one is going back to your example of your guitar and the guitar case. The question is, are there two line items for the guitar and case with separate HTS Schedule B codes?
You can do two line items. But it may be best to just do something like guitar with guitar case and do it as one line item such that it doesn't raise the suspicion from customs. Now, you have to take a look at how you're packaging. So there's a two combo thing here that your guitar and your guitar case have to be shipped together. So you can't just have a box of guitars and a box of guitar cases. You have to have the guitar in the guitar case. When you're shipping this item. So it goes beyond just how you're putting it on your commercial invoice, but also how you're packaging the items. My recommendation would be to just say guitar with guitar case so that it doesn't really look like there's two separate items, but you can list two separate items and do two different values, and sometimes that's easier based on what your ERP system is, but it may raise questions from the customs agent and prompt for an exam. Meaning that the customs agent will go open your boxes and check to see what's really going on. So it's better to probably put it on one line item. That would be my recommendation.
Okay, thank you. The next question is, do you know of any worksheets or tools that can be used to conduct this analysis of classification and also serve as a method to document your determinations?
Yes, and I will. There's a section that we're going through later on, and I'll go through that and show you some different tools that are out there that you can use.
Great. Okay. Another question here. So this is just a clarifying point, Marcy. So HTS is for import to the U.S. and Schedule B is for export from the U.S. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Okay.
The Harmonized Tariff Schedule is a world term. When you're referring to the U.S. import codes, people usually refer to it as the U.S. HTS. But the Harmonized Tariff Schedule or HTS code, the UK has a Harmonized Tariff Schedule or HTS code. Mexico has an HTS code. So it's a worldwide term, Harmonized Tariff Schedule. But yes, it's for importing purposes.
Okay. Another question here. This is an example. If we have a cylinder that contains oxygen, is the essential character of that the container, or is it the oxygen itself?
I would have to know more information, because if it's an oxygen tank for breathing, then it would be the oxygen tank, right? So it kind of depends on what is the container or the tank, and what is it being used for. So we'd need more information on that to classify, and we can take that offline, or if anybody has any questions on certain products, just for the time factor that we have and not having all of the information on the products or specifications, we can kind of take that offline if you need help with classification on different products.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so the next thing is that while there's these general rules of interpretation that apply to the products, once again, those general rules of interpretation are also used worldwide. The U.S. also has their own rules of interpretation, and some of these are, except where specifically noted, the following rules apply. So these are just some key ones that you want to think about when you're classifying your product. End use is determined by use in the U.S. immediately prior to export. Parts classification shall not prevail over specific provisions for such parts as accessories, for example, screws and batteries. So if you have batteries that are going to go into a toy, the battery is not part of the toy. A battery is still a battery. Same thing with screws, and with the other example that we had earlier too was that glass. The safety glass that's used in the aircraft. So if it's being shipped by itself, and it's even though it may be part of an aircraft, if it's called out more specifically somewhere else in the regulations, you have to classify it where it is called out specifically. For classification of goods which a textile material is named, follow the principles in Section 11, Note 2 regarding mixtures of two or more textile materials. I don't want to spend a lot of time on that. If you're dealing with textiles, I feel sorry for you because it's a very tough classification piece of it. But if you have questions on textiles, let me know. We can go into more detail. I would recommend to those companies that do not manufacture textiles, clothing, towels, anything that deals with the textile stuff, don't import those items. And I've worked at a number of companies where marketing decides to go buy t-shirts or shirts overseas and bring them in because they can get a better deal. They really are not going to get a better deal because there's a lot of information that needs to be known about those shirts that probably the person they're buying it from does not know. And that would be things like, what is the blend? Where did the fabric come from? Where was the item sewn? And it goes on and on and on and on. And there's a lot of high costs, duty rates for products depending on countries that they're coming from. For those textiles to come in. So if you run into that, and I know there's a lot of companies that do run into that, just don't even get involved in importing textiles. And if you have a marketing person that's taking shirts, let's say, or towels or some kind of textile overseas to give away at a free trade show, tell them to leave them there or donate them and not bring them back, because it becomes a big pain to bring textiles back into the U.S. The other thing too is pens. Pens are another thing. But if you have questions on that, just send me an email and I will give you the full load on pens coming into the U.S. Other things that you can do are customs rulings. So you've heard me talk a lot about customs rulings. If you've ever dealt with the export perspective of getting an ECCN or getting a USML category, or a commodity jurisdiction from the export side, that's the same thing as what a customs ruling is. It's you're going to U.S. Customs to get a final determination as to what your HTS code would be on your product. So does that mean you need to be sending in rulings for every single product? Absolutely no. Customs will be like, what are you doing? When you're doing a ruling, it is still very much like when you're getting a commodity jurisdiction or when you're getting a commodity classification request from the Bureau of Industry and Security, you need to provide a lot of information. You want to provide specifications, pictures, and in some cases, if you can, provide samples to the customs officials that are looking at it. Describe how you're marketing it, what's it supposed to do, where is it supposed to go into, and all of those legal requirements, going through general rules of interpretation. This is why we think it's this classification. Don't just send them in and say, hey, what's the classification? You really need to tell customs what you believe the classification is, and this is the reason why. They will come back and say, we agree or disagree, and this is the reason why. So one of the things is just to make sure you give them enough information to make that determination. You want to make sure you send it to customs headquarters and not your port director, even though your port directors or your local port can make a determination. What happens is that customs headquarters can always come back and overrule the ports. So you really want to go to the headquarters to get the final determination, because if one port director thinks it's classified one way and another port thinks it's classified a different way, then you have these issues going back and forth, and customs at headquarters is going to tell you what it really should be classified as. So just go straight to the top in this particular case to get the classifications. So there was a question about helpful tools. So here are some helpful tools that you want to take a look at. The World Customs Organization publishes explanatory notes. They're about $200-$300. You can purchase them online. There are some other, you just go to the World Customs Organization website. There's a place where you can get them and download them, but there's also companies here in the U.S. that sell the explanatory notes. These explanatory notes, they're not free, but they give a little bit more detail in regards to certain header or headings and certain HTS codes that are not necessarily in the headers or the section notes, or the section notes or the chapter notes. They go into a little bit more detail. If you do a lot of importing and you have a lot of different products, I would urge you or encourage you to buy a copy of these explanatory notes. They generally are good for 3 to 4 years. What happens is the World Customs Organization does a rewrite of the Harmonized Tariff Schedule generally every 5 years. Does that mean that every HTS code changes? No, but when there's major changes to the Harmonized Tariff Schedule, it happens every 5 years, and that's when they update those explanatory notes. And there's some updates throughout the years, but you really want to get the purchase or purchase a new copy every 5 years if you're not doing it every year. And I don't think you really need to do it every year. It just depends on your products and what happens in those regulations. But if you import a variety of different types of products, I would encourage you to do that, because there's more information in regards to what falls under something. There's more definitions and more explanation as to why something would fall under an HTS code than what you'd find in the section notes and the chapter notes in the HTS book. Another good tool is the Census website. I put a link up to that. This link, let's see if I can get to there. This is where I was talking about earlier, where you can put in a description of your product. So if we do things like the vacuum, oops, if I could spell it right, it should come up, and it's going to start asking you questions. You can kind of click through the regulations here. So it has an electric motor. Is the motor self-contained in the vacuum? You push yes. Is less or equal to 1,500 watts, or is it greater than 1,500 watts? Let's say it's equal to. Is there a receptacle? So like the bag or something that comes out, and is it less than or equal to the 20? And then if you say yes, then it gets you down. So if you remember in the beginning of the presentation, this is where we talked about the how you go back through it. Now, can you use this as your legal argument? No. This is only there for a tool. Your legal argument of why you classified something the way that you classified it has got to be, it's a vacuum cleaner. It does have its self-contained motor. Here's my specification that shows it's a vacuum cleaner, and it's a 1,500-watt vacuum cleaner. It's self-contained and has a receptacle that meets the 20-liter requirement. Okay, That's your legal determination. These are here only for a tool. And I would also tell folks that if you're just doing HTS codes, this is also a good way to start, is to go to the Census website and do this, because Customs doesn't have the same thing. Another good site to use is CROSS. CROSS is the Customs Regulations Online Search System. So if people that have submitted the rulings, Customs has published what the rulings are for those items. So if you want to do, let's do the safety glass. For aircraft. Let's see if that comes up. And as you can see, you're going to have to try different ways of getting it there. So if you're looking up safety glass, then it's going to give you all the rulings that are similar or have some kind of reference to safety glass. So you can see there's a safety glass for ready-to-assemble tabletops and doors. What you're going to see here are the ruling numbers. So these are the case numbers, basically, is those ruling numbers. We talked about New York office or the headquarters office. That's what the HQ means. So there may be different ports that have come back with that ruling. This will give you a little idea as to what the rulings were for. So for this particular one, it is classification. For this particular ruling, it was based on marking. So you want to take a look. You can always open them up, and you'll get the letter that Customs sent back. So Customs doesn't put your proprietary data out there or your specifications. You do have to tell them when you're sending in a ruling what to cross off and what to keep out of these documents. But as you can see, here's what comes back. It's the explanation from Customs as to why they classified something the way that they did. And so if you are getting ready to write a ruling, I would encourage you to look at some of these rulings or see if there's rulings that are out there. You can always reference other people's rulings if you're going in, or when you're classifying an item, you can reference a ruling and say, I classified my item this way because I think it meets the same requirements that were met under this ruling number, blah, blah, blah. I will caution you. Make sure you take a look at the dates of these rulings. So some of these rulings are very, very old. Some of these HTS codes may no longer be here, so keep going through. Some of the rulings have been recalled, meaning that they actually aren't good anymore, but they're still out here. So you want to make sure that you're looking through it and doing really good research on these items under these classifications. Okay, but this is another tool that you can use to kind of help you get classifications and get yourself steered in the right direction. Another tool that you can use is the HTS index, and so there's a link to that. I've got a little snapshot of that in there. You can take a look at the items, but once again, when we talked about it earlier, these are really tools. These are not something you can use as legal advice. Same thing with HTS index, the census website. All of these things are not, cannot be your legal requirement except for your rulings. Okay, all these other things are just tools to help you get to that classification. I'll also tell you a lot of manufacturers post their HTS codes in things like your ECCNs and their USML categories, not necessarily USML categories, but ECCNs on their company website too. If you're the manufacturer, obviously you're going to have to do your own classification, but if you're a reseller or a distributor and you're buying something from another company, I always go back to your manufacturer or your supplier and ask them for the classification. You should always do your own checking because as an importer, you are still responsible for the correct classification, but it's a good place to start. And even if you're buying it from someone in Japan, for example, the first six digits should be the same as they are here in the U.S. So it's a good place to start and look at their requirements and what their arguments are for classifying something that way. They know a little bit more about the products that they've manufactured, so a good place to start is with your supplier. That brings us to the end of the presentation, so I'm going to ask if there's any other questions.
At this point, Marcy, we have a lot of people who are asking specific questions around specific products, so I'm just going to ask those folks to follow up with us via email because I think we're going to need a lot more detail than you're providing. And there is, as you can see, just based on this material, there's no simple answer to a lot of these things. So if you do have a specific product or a specific question on how to interpret a GRI, we can try to help you with that offline. There is one question. How can you tell if a cross-ruling has been obsoleted or inactivated?
Sometimes in there, you will find that they've posted that it has been rescinded. But another way to tell, is that you have to keep looking through and looking at the dates. If you can take a look at some of these things, I don't think there's probably any in here that have been rescinded. Yeah, there's not. You can tell by the date. So I would say go down and look at the one with the HTS code that is the same HTS code and it's the same product. So you can see that these are a lot of different items that are in here. But take a look at the dates, because what will happen is that, and then look at the latest date. The latest date will in there say that they're rescinding ruling number, blah, blah, blah. So always look at the latest date for that same type of product and classification, if that makes sense.
Great. That's all the questions we have. Like I said, we'll take the other ones offline.
Okay. And here's my information again, too, if you need anything. Tom will get some of the questions from the emails and from the Q&A on the website, and we'll get back to you as soon as we can.
Great. Well, thanks, Marcy, for that information. I really do appreciate it. It was good and very thorough and helpful. I'd like to thank everybody for joining today, and just as a reminder, we will have this presentation posted on our website, typically within 1 week of today's session, so check back out mid-next week on our website, which is exportsolutionsinc.com, and you can view a recording of this session and also download a copy of the slides for free. I want to thank everybody for joining today. Please join us again for a future webinar, and I hope you all have a great afternoon. Take care.